Hi, I'm Christy. This is my honey Chris and our children Justin, Caitlin, and Jordan. The Clovermead Adventure Farm belongs to our family.
So a little family history here. My grandfather kept bees in the Netherlands, and four of his six boys became beekeepers in Canada. And one of those boys is my dad, who in 1975 started his bee business right here on this farm with my mom.
We would like to share a little about the world of honeybees and our family business with you. It's only 12 minutes long, so we are going to fly. See if you can count all the bee puns.
So, this is a beehive, the wooden box that a colony of honeybees live in, and call it home sweet home. There are between 20 and 50,000 bees that live in this hive, depending on the time of year. Clovermead keeps around 600 hives, with an average of 40,000 bees per hive. It's why we can say that Clovermead is home to 24 million bees. That's right, 24 million bees. So, most of our bees do not live on our farm, and that's a good thing. Over 24 million bees flying over our heads, it'd be kind of hard to see the sun shining. Our beehives are spread out in groups of 20 to 30 hives across beautiful rural Elgin County.
Here's my dad, one of the beekeepers at Clovermead. He's going through a beehive, making sure that the hive is thriving and behaving. He checks for evidence that the queen is alive and well, and checks for diseases and parasitic mites. Mites are the little bad guys. They're like little vampires that suck the bee's blood. It's the reddish-brown spider-like creature on the back of the bee. Mites are just trying to survive off the bees, but mites can destroy a colony and make a beekeeper cry.
So this is what the inside of a beehive looks like. It is made of these wooden frames which are filled with cells on each side. There are around 7,000 cells on each frame. Wow! So that makes a lot of cupboard and food storage space for the bees.
The cells are built by the bees with beeswax. Now you are wondering where the beeswax comes from? Well, tiny flakes of wax come out of the wax glands on the bee's abdomen. The bees take these pieces of wax and form them into cells. Cells have six-sided design, so very little beeswax material is used. But cells can hold a lot of weight and volume. Each cell is on a slight angle so that the honey does not run out. Cells are multi-purpose. Sometimes they are used like kitchen cupboards to store honey or pollen inside. And sometimes the queen will lay one egg in each cell, kind of like a baby crib. So who's the most important bee in the hive? The queen bee. Just like in your home, there's only one queen in a beehive, not two or three queens. If there was more than one, they would have a royal duel, until there's only the strongest queen left, ruling, waving, and smiling. Her job is to lay up to 1,500 eggs a day during the peak summer months. She can live for 3 to 5 years, so the more eggs that she lays, the more bees will hatch. And the bigger the bee workforce is to collect food and prepare the hive for the upcoming winter.
So, these are worker bees. You can tell by their name and title that they do all the work. Perhaps that's why they only live 6 weeks in the summer. Household chores are similar to what you do in your home. Bees collect food from the flowers, polish up empty cells, clean the hive and take out the rubbish, take care of the eggs, larvae, and the young babies, feed and care for the queen bee, defend the hive from robbers, and communicate with each other by buzzing and waggle dancing. Worker bees are only females, never males.
The worker bee visits flowers and sips up the nectar with its proboscis, which is a fancy name for an insect tongue. Once the bee's honey sac is filled with nectar, the bee flies back home. She will pass the nectar over to another bee through her proboscis, who will churn that nectar in her honey stomach and add enzymes to the nectar to create honey. Then that honeybee will put the honey into the polished honey cells for storage. But wait, it's not really honey yet. The work is not done. The bees will need to get really busy and use their wings to fan and dry out the extra water that's in the nectar. Nectar needs to go down from 80% moisture down low, 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 low to 17%. At that point, it will be thick, sweet honey in the cell, which will last a long time. Kind of like making maple syrup, but not using heat.
A little bit more on drone bees. These bees are males. So So drones are different than the warplanes that fly quietly in the sky overhead. They don't drop bombs. These bees don't do sting operations. They actually have no stinger, so they can't sting. Don't expect to see drones out of the hive working on flowers. They just don't collect food or do any work. Nothing. None. None at all. They just watch the worker bees. For the first part of a drone's life, they stay in the hive, eating the stores of the food that the worker bees collect. Until they're mature, then on warm, sunny afternoons, they go out cruising, you know, flying around the countryside, looking for a beautiful young queen to date. Generally, the males will search their entire lives, never finding one. Probably a bit depressing for them. Despite the fact that drones do not do any work in the hive, they're still really important to the survival of each hive. And this is because they are needed to marry and mate with brand new queens from other hives, so that those young queens can lay fertilized eggs and those hives can raise lots of new worker bees.
So why do honeybees make honey? Is it just for you to put on your peanut butter sandwich or put in your tea or on your ice cream? It's actually because they need the honey to survive the Canadian winter or for long periods of time when there are no flowers available for bees to feed on. Bees are actually awake all winter, so they eat food when it's cold outside, when they are inside, and cluster together, shivering from the cold. Each summer, bees usually produce extra honey, so we take some of their extra honey and leave the rest for them for the winter. They need at least 80 of these jars of honey to get through winter. In addition, they will make 60 extra jars for us, depending on the summer weather. So, 600 hives is 36,000 jars. Just say wow.
So how do we get sweet honey into a glass jar? The hardest part is for the bees. They have to fly 88,000 kilometers to collect nectar from 2 million flowers in order to fill a 500 gram jar like this. Say what? Fly 88,000 kilometers and visit 2 million flowers just to fill this one jar of honey. So who works harder, you or the bees? So how do we harvest honey? We take the heavy honey boxes off the top of the hives when they are full, usually in August and September. Then we blow the bees out with our bee blower. It's a fancy term for a leaf blower. We bring the boxes home to our honey factory, where we cut the wax tops off the cells on each side of the frame. Then we spin the frames really fast in a circle to create a centrifugal effect. And the honey flies out of the cells, runs down the inside of the honey extractor, and then is pumped into a big tank. We pour it into some honey barrels till we need the honey for our shop, and then we fill it into smaller containers for you. So why are there 6 different floral source honeys in the big tanks in the Clovermead store? A honeybee can fly a 3 kilometer radius from its hive and cover something like 8,000 hectares of land. So if the beehives are placed by a big field of clover flowers, you'll be getting clover honey if the weather and conditions are perfect. The same goes for buckwheat honey. Have your beehives near a field of buckwheat flowers and you may end up with buckwheat honey. The interesting thing about buckwheat honey is that the nectar is a dark color, giving a strong tasting honey. But if you look at the color of the buckwheat flower, it is actually white. So depending on what flowers are blooming near the bees, they'll actually determine the taste, the aroma, and color of honey. Everyone has their own favorite. Certain flowers, like fall goldenrod, are open at only one time of the year. So when we take the honey boxes off the hives, we check to see if it's a unique floral source of honey. If so, we keep it separate when we harvest it for you.
Why does my honey go rock hard or crystallize? All the honey in the Clovermead store will go rock hard eventually. This is a natural characteristic of honey. So remember, please don't throw it out. It's not bad, it's normal. The unpasteurized honey granulates really quickly at a cool temperature of 14 degrees Celsius. Keeping honey warm at a normal hive temperature or keeping it frozen in a freezer will slow it down from granulating. Putting it in the fridge is not a good idea. To liquefy honey, you need to put the honey jar in a bath of hot water. The heat will cause the honey to liquefy again. Creamed honey is actually granulated honey that has been churned or whipped
so that you have a nice, smooth, spreadable honey. Honey spreads are made with creamed honey, but to give it extra flavor, they have a special spice or oil added to the honey. Some favorites include cinnamon spread, lemon spread, or honey butter. Try a free sample at our honey bar and discover your favorite honey.
Pollination. When bees are visiting flowers and collecting pollen and nectar, did you know that they're helping fruits and vegetables grow? Bees are important to our ecosystem. If they weren't around, we would not have a lot of the food that we eat and enjoy. Here's an apple orchard. Our bees are placed in the apple orchards just when the flowers are about ready to bloom. The apple farmer knows that these bees are needed, otherwise he will not produce a big crop of apples. As the worker bee is busy collecting nectar and pollen from the apple blossoms, she'll be climbing around on top of the flower, trying to mop up as much pollen as possible on her body. Pollen is like the bee's bread, and a worker bee brings it back to the hive to share with the rest of the bees. As bees are visiting flowers, a bit of pollen dust from one flower gets carried over to the next flower accidentally on the bee. This is what we call cross-pollination. Without cross-pollination, we would not be able to enjoy crunching on an apple. Bees are directly connected to one-third of the food in your grocery cart. Here are some pictures of some fruits and vegetables that bees are pollinating.
Honeybees make a special food for the queen bee and young growing larvae called royal jelly. Royal jelly has lots of B vitamins. People will eat a little royal jelly to help with stress and also to raise energy levels. Propolis is a sticky substance that the bees make by collecting resin from around the tree buds. Honeybees like to seal cracks and gaps in their hives with propolis. That way they can create airflow through the hive by fanning their wings to help evaporate moisture from the hive and to keep the hive cool in the summer. Bees also coat the inside of the walls of the hive with propolis because it helps inhibit the growth of bacteria in the warm and crowded beehive. People with propolis to help fight off colds and flus, they also put on their cuts because it acts as an antibiotic. Honey, beeswax, pollen, propolis, royal jelly, and pollination are all products and services from honeybees that people use. Recently, scientists have announced that they have discovered that the venom in a bee stinger can kill the HIV virus. Please remember that honeybees are much more important than just for making honey.
Have you ever seen a clump of bees like this on a tree or bush? The queen has left her crowded home with half of the worker bees, and her scout bees are looking for a new home. The bees will rest in a clump until the scout bees have found the perfect new home for the hive. This usually happens within the day. A new home would be in a hollow tree or, unfortunately, sometimes in the wall cavity of a home.
So Dad, people are wondering, why do the bees keep dying?
It's not just honeybees, it's also native bees. It's butterflies, bats, songbirds, frogs, aquatic life, fish in the lakes and streams. Natural areas and habitat where insects and wildlife live are being reduced in size. There's pollution of the natural environment. And newly designed high-tech pesticides are better at killing insects. So from the new pesticides, there is friendly fire or collateral damage to the bees. In our increasingly globalized world, diseases and parasites are being transported around the world more easily, so that bees are exposed to new parasites and diseases that they've never adapted to.
So Dad, what can people do if they want to help?
Plant flowers that are bee-friendly. This helps provide bees with nutritious food all season long so that they're not stressed for food, and so that they can forage on plants that have never been sprayed with pesticides. Set some land aside or leave some space in your backyard and let it grow back to natural. Don't drain the wetlands. Reconstruct the wetlands again. Ask for stringent testing on the new high-tech pesticides before they're approved for use. So the message from our family to your family is, together families should care. We should care about the natural creation because it's there for every family to enjoy, steward, and savor. Thanks for coming to Clover Mead.
Don't worry, be happy.
song he wrote. You might want to sing it note for note. Don't worry, be happy. In every life we have some trouble, but when you worry you make it double. Don't worry, be happy. Place to lay your head. Somebody came and took your bed. Don't worry, be happy. The landlord say your rent is late. He may have to litigate, but don't worry, be happy. Cash, ain't got no style, ain't got no gal to make you smile, but don't worry, be happy. 'Cause when you worry, your face will frown, and that will bring everybody down. So don't worry, be happy.